right, today we are going to discuss Jason versus, we're going to review the way to do the dictionary example with Jason. Depending on how far we will get today, we will probably have time to work on any lab assignments that you have outstanding on Wednesday. So I do not know if I'll have a full lecture on Wednesday of this week. Before we look at the Jason example, let's take a second to review what exactly Jason is. Jason stands for JavaScript Object Notation, so JSON, and it uses sort of the same structure that we use in JavaScript when we create something, such as when we create a new array. There's a notation to create an array in JavaScript, and that's a form of JSON. The advantages of JSON versus XML is that JSON is more lightweight. By more lightweight, I mean that there's less overhead. Remember we talked about overhead, and we compared the overhead of delimited data with the overhead of XML. And we found that XML, there's a lot more overhead in that. Here's a couple of articles, and I'm sure you could search around and find a few other ones that sort of compares and contrasts JSON versus XML. Here's a page at sort of JSON's official page. Strictly speaking, JSON is a data interchange standard. It's easy for humans to read and write. I would argue that XML is easier for humans to read than JSON is. Because if we look at JSON, well, that's not a specific example. Here's an example of JSON versus XML. There is an example of XML code that looks like that. Here's an example of JSON code. And without the tags, I think JSON is actually a little harder for humans to read. As far as writing it, it's probably a wash. It's probably about as even. But JSON, I would argue that JSON might be a little harder for humans to read. All right? But as you can see, when you compare the overhead, and again, they don't really use the exact same example here. One does allergies, one does books. But you can see there's a lot less overhead with JSON than there is. Namely because in JSON there really isn't any ending tags. You simply use parentheses and curly brackets and square brackets to indicate the ending of something. There is the equivalent of tag names that are contained in here. All right. And we'll look at it. Here's a diagram. think is supposed to simply show the way JSON file looks, JSON data looks. And I think I understand the JSON format in this diagram is hard for me to read. So instead of looking at that, this diagram, there that answers all your questions about how JSON is structured, right? I think instead of looking at it, it's probably best to look at an example. The JSON page itself calls itself lightweight, and at one place I think they jokingly call themselves the fat-free alternative to XML. All right, it is a standard, and it's a format that can be used across different languages. That it shares with both XML and delimited data. Here's an example. And again, you have curly brackets around a block of data, just like you use curly brackets around a block of instructions in JavaScript. So that's pretty consistent. You then say what the name of the first piece of data is. All right? Now, the first piece of data could be something simple, like just a string, or it could be something more complex, like an array. So in this case, this is an array. And the array is named books. And what does that consist of? Well, in JSON, there's a colon to separate the value or the name of the field from the value. In that respect, it's very similar to CSS, right? Where we use a colon to separate the name of the attribute from the value. And in this particular case, books is an array. And it's an array that contains two elements. Again, each of those elements uses the curly bracket to indicate the beginning of the first element and the beginning of the second element. So let's go and let's copy this to a text editor and let's see what the XML version of this data would look like. And I'll put them in the same document. So that's what the JSON version looks like. Actually, I lied. I'll put them in a different document. That way I can save each of them and we can compare file sizes. The XML for this would look like this. Books, ending books tag, So if you're going to look at the XML versus the JSON for this, that would be the XML. this would be the corresponding JSON. And I would argue that the XML is easier for a human to read than JSON is. All right, let's save both of these. And I'll save both of these as plain text files. So I'll go and I'll save this as JSON. I'll save this as XML. And if we look at the relative sizes of these, the JSON text is 182 bytes, the XML text is 181 bytes. I lied. This is a rare instance where XML data ends up smaller than JSON. I find that interesting. Maybe if it was compressed, maybe that would. If you got rid of some of these extra spaces. I don't know. That's a good question. All right. At any rate, it's an alternative, and it does a similar thing. And you can see by the use of the parentheses and the curly brackets and the square brackets, you can designate a structure just like you do within XML. All right, so it has that advantage over delimited data. Remember, with delimited data, it's possible, but it's tricky to designate a structure where you have things that are nested, like you have nested tags. For XML, that's exactly where XML earns its keep, right, is it's able to implement a structure. And JSON does a similar thing, and arguably, at least in many cases, it does it in a more lightweight way than XML does. All right, so let's look at the dictionary example. Oh, why would you choose one versus the other? That's a good question. One of the things that you would consider would be if you're using a tool that makes the creation of one or the other of them easy. All right. You may, for example, already have libraries of XML stuff that will make the creation of XML easy for you. So in which case, maybe you want to use XML. You might consider the volume of data. If you were dealing with a structure where there was a lot of data, you might want to consider using JSON simply because that may cut down on the overhead. Although in the example we saw, it really didn't. But in most cases, I think you'll find that JSON will produce less data. So if you're sending a small amount of data, that may not matter. But if you're sending a great deal of data, that could add up. The bottom line is that there's an alternative, and it's not a case of you would always use one versus the other. And you should be familiar with both, because you may be on a project where one is being used, and you need to know how to use it and deal with it. So let's look at the dictionary example. I think I already copied that to the server. Let's see. All right. Again, same thing. Type in a letter, get all these, click on that, you get your answer. Let's look, and first of all, let's run the server-side code by itself. I can't emphasize this enough, the benefit of doing that, because that will actually show you what the server is going to be returning. And if that isn't correct, then again, nothing else can work correctly. So that's what we get with JSON. In fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to compare our data. XML and JSON. XML. In this case, we end up with a smaller file of JSON. JSON is 868 bytes. XML is like 1500 bytes. So almost on the order of almost half as much JSON is. Not quite, but of that order. And I suspect that would be the case in more realistic examples, that you would save quite a bit of space. All right. So let's take a closer look at this, and let me put some extra line feeds in here so that we see exactly what this works like, exactly what this looks like. And I'm going to sort of describe this in words as we break this down. First of all, word list is what? It's an array, right? How do I know it's an array? Because after it, I have the square bracket. So this JSON data consists of an array. What is included in that array? Well, a bunch of elements are included in that array. So as I go in and indent each of those a little bit, everything included in the curly brackets is an array element. And what does each array element consist of? Each array element consists of a word and an index. Now, where are we done with the array? We're done with the array when we hit the last element and then there's a curly bracket. That curly bracket matches up with that curly bracket and indicates that everything between there and there is an array. Each array element, each individual array element, consists of the stuff included in a curly bracket, and every array element included in the curly bracket has a word associated with it, and it has an index associated with it. Now, JSON is called JSON because JavaScript object notation. All right? Which means the way that we're going to reference these elements is similar to the way that we reference the DOM in JavaScript. And again, that's a similarity with XML, right? Remember, we use commands on XML data just like we use commands on the HTML DOM. Well, we're going to use a similar sort of syntax to refer to JSON data. We're going to refer to the elements in JSON data the same way we refer to elements in JavaScript. Refer to objects and their properties in JavaScript. Alright, so let's take a look. First, we're going to look at the code that creates the JSON data. And then we're going to look at the code that parses it. I'll spend a minute talking about this stuff because remember when we compared XML to delimited, only two pieces of the puzzle changed, right? Creating the object was the same. Creating the request object was the same, right? Because all that is a pipeline. That's the manner in which we exchange data between the client and the server. So the fact that we're exchanging data, we need one of those objects. It doesn't matter what kind of data we're exchanging. So that's going to be the same whether we use delimited, XML, or JSON. Making the request is the same. We are still asking for the same thing, and we're going to ask for the same thing the same way. By creating a URL, and by passing on the URL as part of it, as part of the query string, the specific data that we're interested in. In this particular case, the word or portion of a word that we're interested in. So that part stays the same. What is going to be different, however, is going to be this function. The function that actually parses, that is, the function that actually breaks down that big chunk of JSON data into its individual pieces so that we can make a dropdown. And that was different for delimited, that was different for XML, and that will be different from JSON. Finally, that last request, remember, we didn't touch that because there was no need to. Sort of simpler even than delimited data is a case where we're getting back just one piece of data from the server. Then there's no parsing involved at all. We simply get back the value from the server and we're done with it. Now again, notice in all these cases, whether we're talking about delimited data, XML, or JSON, we are simply returning back the data. We're not doing any formatting of the data. We're not creating an XML or an HTML table or whatever. The reason for that is, remember, that it's the client's job to format the data. We could actually use the same server-side scripting scripts in a number of different applications that format the data differently. All right? It's the server's job to supply the data because that's what servers do. To manipulate a pre-existing web page and to change the way it looks, that's the job of JavaScript. That was the job of JavaScript since day one in this class. So we leave what we're doing with that data up to the client. In other words, what you could do, I'm not saying it's correct, but what you could do is have your server-side code output a dropdown. And then you just do inner HTML equals, boom, the value of the dropdown. All right. Then you wouldn't have to worry about the code to parse it and break it down. That's not as good as simply sending the data back, because sending the data back, again, each thing services a little component. We could keep that server-side script always pumping out the data, and we could write several different client-side scripts to use that data in a different way. All right? It's sort of like what we did with the function with the tuition calculation. Right? The function for the tuition calculation should simply return a number. This is a tuition. Now, whether that number gets displayed on a page or gets displayed as part of an AJAX application, or we create a table that contains the list of tuitions for the different residency status, that doesn't matter. The function just does its job of displaying the data, and that's what we're going to do here as well. All right. So let's start off looking at the server-side code that actually creates the JSON data. Again, that's going to be dictionary1.php. We have our include file that contains our two arrays. We grab the value from the query string. We create a result string. But again, compare this to XML. It's very, very, very similar. What's different is the separators between the pieces of data. With XML, we use tags. So let's bring up the XML version of it on the screen next to it. With XML, we started our results equaling a word list tag. here we start off with that. Pretty much the same idea, though, right? A designation that what we have coming up is a word list. Each iteration through the loop, then, in the case of XML, we outputted the tags for an item, for a word, and for an index. Here we output an array element that contains a word, and the word, the index, and the index. So really, the process to create this is the same. The only thing that's different is what we would probably expect to be different. The stuff that we're putting between the data values, right? Because that's been our whole challenge since the beginning, since we've looked at comparing the three ways of doing this. Excuse me. Is how to separate the data, right? We're sending back data, but we're not sending back one piece of data, we're sending back a bunch of data. Well, how do we tell the client how that data is grouped together? Well, that's our options, right? We can delimit it, we can separate it by semicolons or colons or commas or whatever. We can put it in an XML data, or we can put it in JSON data. So really, the outputting of the data is the same, except the stuff that we're sticking in between the pieces of data. That's really, in a nutshell, the difference between the two. When we're all done, we end our word list. We have a little catch in case there is no words to output a little message in JSON saying that there are no words. And we're done with it. Now, the tough part, again, is actually parsing that data. So let's look at the code that does that for JSON. One thing you might have noticed, I didn't point it out, but I will go and point it out now, is that in the case of HTML, remember that we changed the header that the server was sending out to say, to tell the client that we are sending back that we are sending back XML as opposed to some other kind of data. We do not do that in the case of JSON. So we're not sending back XML. Of course not. We're sending back JSON data. Which means what? Which means that impacts what on the client side? Whether we're sending back XML or not XML. What does that impact on the client side? Close. It affects where the data comes back. And the data either comes back as part of the request object's response text, or it comes back as part of the object's response XML. So that's the two places that the data can come back to the client, either in response text or in response XML. If it comes back as response XML, the client knows it's XML data. So we can instantly start using XML functions. Remember, get tags by ID and that sort of thing. Because we know that what we're getting back is XML. If we send JSON data back, though, we send it back really the same way that we send back delimited data. And that is as part of the response text. So, the client doesn't know that it's JSON data until we tell it to treat it like JSON data. Once we tell it to treat it like JSON data, then we can start using it like JSON data. Well, how do we tell it it's JSON data? We do it this way, with an eval function. We take the response text that we get back from the client and we use the eval function to create a response object. Response is going to be an object. Well, what properties is that object going to have? Well, it's the properties that we put in the JSON data. So it's going to have a wordless property that's going to be an array. And for every element in the wordless property, there's going to be a word property, and there's going to be an index property. All right? So effectively what this does is this creates a string. I'm sorry, this takes a string and creates a JavaScript object from it called response. And when we can then use our mechanism and our style of coding to access the properties of that object. All right? So we do all the stuff that we did before. We create an option object. We zero out the length of the dropdown. I then loop how many times? Well, however big the word list is. Executing this statement creates an object. That's the important thing to realize. It takes a string, which is just a string of data like any other string of data, and makes it into a JavaScript object. As a JavaScript object, we can refer to attributes of that JavaScript object. What's one of the attributes of that JavaScript object? The word list. What kind of data is a word list? It is an array. Therefore, I can say response.wordlist in the response object that I created from the JSON string. Look at the word list array and give me the length of it. And that causes this loops statement, these loop statements, to execute one time for every element that is in the word list array that's associated with that JSON data. We then do what? I grab the word attribute for each element in turn. So I will equal 0 the first time through. I will equal 1 the second time through. And so I grab that element in the array and grab the word attribute associated with it. So let's go back to our browser. I ask for the length of the word list array. That counts how many elements are in here. And it looks like there's 27 of them, right? So I'm going to do this loop 27 times. Each time through, I'm going to look at the next element in that array. So the first time through, I look at element 0. The second time through, I look at element 1. The third time through, I look at element 3, and so on down the line. I then ask for that array element. Give me the word attribute. And give me the index attribute. And I use those to create my drop-down element.
Is 21 and 22 missing in that? I see 20 and then it goes to 23.
Good eye. Let's look, see what's up with those. I have a guess as to what that is. My guess is capital A. So yeah, this is written to be case sensitive. That's a good, you know, I don't know how many years I've used this example, and I think you're the first student to notice that. But yeah, the matching that I'm doing is case sensitive, therefore it's missing those because, yeah. It would also miss these.
Yeah.
excellent question. And we need to do that on the server side, right? Because the server side is what's pumping out the data. All right. Okay. So again, we loop through the results that we get. And for each element, we grab the word attribute and the index attribute and create our dropdown. Because again, each element in the array has a word attribute and an index attribute. We pull those out from the return data and we create our dropdown. Questions about this? How are we going to fix this bug though? You're on the right track. I think you have the details incorrect. Let's look and analyze the problem. The offending statement is this one. Because this takes the word that we've entered in and looks to see what position that word is in our English language word. And the problem with that is that if I look for a capital A, it's looking for a capital A. All right? So if I type in a lowercase a, and there's no lowercase a's, but there's a capital A, it's not going to find it.
What if you were to type it in, you know, the user type in a capital A, would those two only show up then?
Good question. Let's try that. Sure does. We essentially have to tell our code that it doesn't matter what case it is. All right? Probably the most straightforward way to do that is I'm going to convert my word and I'm going to convert what the user types in to all lowercase. And then I'll look for the presence of the string. That way, if it's a mix of upper and lowercase, and if it's all lowercase or all uppercase or a mix of both, it doesn't matter because my comparison is only going to look at data that's been converted to all lowercase, both my word and my string. So how do I convert a JavaScript string to lowercase? All right, the to lowercase method does that. So I can go here and say look for the position not in the word itself but in the word after it's been converted to lowercase. And I can compare that to the word that I typed in after it's been converted to lowercase. So I can save that. what just happened there?
Yeah.
I'm going to rename it to I know what I did. I copied it. I had two folders both pointing to the desktop instead of one folder pointing to. What did I do, being the big dummy that I am? This isn't JavaScript code, this is PHP code. So what I should have looked at is PHP convert, string convert lowercase, and it is str lower. Except it is str2 lower. Wow. One more time. Those extra words in there. Now that's assuming that that's the functionality that we want, which I would think in a case like this it probably would be. If we type in an A, it would kind of be weird to type in an A and get and not get those things. So again, I would assume that's the functionality that I wanted. I suppose in some cases that you might want it to be case sensitive. All right. At any rate, are there any questions? I won't post this example. If you want to correct it, you can. It'll be a good exercise for you. The classic instructor disclaimer. Any questions about this? All right, what we will do on Wednesday is we will come here. I have Another example that I want to go over real quick, and in the remainder of time you can work on your any assignments that you have due. I posted an announcement concerning the final and when everything, sort of like the final drop dead due date. All right, we'll see you over in lab. Does anyone have a U.S.? All right, today we are going to discuss JSON versus, we're going to review the way to do the dictionary example with JSON. Depending on how far we will get today, we will probably have time to work on any lab assignments that you have outstanding on Wednesday. So I do not know if I'll have a full lecture on Wednesday of this week. Before we look at the JSON example, let's take a second to review what exactly JSON is. JSON stands for JavaScript Object Notation. So JSON. And it uses sort of the same structure that we use in JavaScript when we create something, such as when we create a new array. There's a notation to create an array in JavaScript, and that's a form of JSON. The advantages of JSON versus XML is that JSON is more lightweight. By more lightweight, I mean that there's less overhead. Remember we talked about overhead, and we compared the overhead of delimited data with the overhead of XML. And we found that XML, there's a lot more overhead in that. Here's a couple of articles, and I'm sure you could search around and find a few other ones that sort of compares and contrasts JSON versus XML. Here's a page at sort of JSON's official page. Strictly speaking, JSON is a data interchange standard. It's easy for humans to read and write. I would argue that XML is easier for humans to read than JSON is. Because if we look at JSON, well, that's not a specific example. Here's an example of JSON versus XML. There is an example of XML code that looks like that. Here's an example of JSON code. And without the tags, I think JSON is actually a little harder for humans to read. As far as writing it, it's probably a wash. It's probably about as even. But JSON, I would argue that JSON might be a little harder for humans to read. All right? But as you can see, when you compare the overhead, and again, they don't really use the exact same example here. One does allergies, one does books. But you can see there's a lot less overhead with JSON than there is Namely because in JSON there really isn't any ending tags. You simply use parentheses and curly brackets and square brackets to indicate the ending of something. There is the equivalent of tag names that are contained in here. Alright. And we'll look at it. Here's a diagram that I think is supposed to simply show the way JSON file looks, JSON data looks. And I think I understand the JSON format in this diagram is hard for me to read. So instead of looking at that, this diagram, there that answers all your questions about how JSON is structured, right? I think instead of looking at it, it's probably best to look at an example. The JSON page itself calls itself lightweight, and at one place I think they jokingly call themselves the fat-free alternative to XML. All right, it is a standard, and it's a format that can be used across different languages. That it shares with both XML and delimited data. Here's an example. And again, you have curly brackets around a block of data, just like you use curly brackets around a block of instructions in JavaScript. So that's pretty consistent. You then say what the name of the first piece of data is. All right? Now, the first piece of data could be something simple, like just a string, or it could be something more complex, like an array. So, in this case, this is an array. And the array is named books. And what does that consist of? Well, in JSON, there's a colon to separate the value or the name of the field from the value. In that respect, it's very similar to CSS, right? Where we use a colon to separate the name of the attribute from the value. And in this particular case, books is an array. And it's an array that contains two elements. Again, each of those elements uses the curly bracket to indicate the beginning of the first element and the beginning of the second element. So let's go and let's copy this to a text editor and let's see what the XML version of this data would look like. And I'll put them in the same document. So that's what the JSON version looks like. Actually, I lied. I'll put them in a different document. That way I can save each of them and we can compare file sizes. The XML for this would look like this. Books. Ending books tag, So if you're going to look at the XML versus the JSON for this, that would be the XML. This would be the corresponding JSON. And I would argue that the XML is easier for a human to read than JSON is. All right. Let's save both of these. And I'll save both of these as plain text files. So I'll go and I'll save this as JSON. I'll save this as XML. And if we look at the relative sizes of these, the JSON text is 182 bytes, the XML text is 181 bytes. I lied. This is a rare instance where XML data ends up smaller than JSON. I find that interesting. Maybe if it was compressed, maybe that would. If you got rid of some of these extra spaces. I don't know. That's a good question. All right. At any rate, it's an alternative, and it does a similar thing. And you can see by the use of the parentheses and the curly brackets and the square brackets, you can designate a structure just like you do within XML. All right, so it has that advantage over delimited data. Remember, with delimited data, it's possible, but it's tricky to designate a structure where you have things that are nested, like you have nested tags. For XML, that's exactly where XML earns its keep, right? Is it's able to implement a structure. And JSON does a similar thing, and arguably, at least in many cases, it does it in a more lightweight way than XML does. All right, so let's look at the dictionary example. Oh, why would you choose one versus the other? That's a good question. One of the things that you would consider would be if you're using a tool that makes the creation of one or the other of them easy. All right. You may, for example, already have libraries of XML stuff that will make the creation of XML easy for you. So in which case, maybe you want to use XML. You might consider the volume of data. If you were dealing with a structure where there was a lot of data, you might want to consider using JSON simply because that may cut down on the overhead. Although in the example we saw, it really didn't. But in most cases, I think you'll find that JSON will produce less data. So if you're sending a small amount of data, that may not matter. But if you're sending a great deal of data, that could add up. The bottom line is that there's an alternative, and it's not a case of you would always use one versus the other. And you should be familiar with both, because you may be on a project where one is being used and you need to know how to use it and deal with it. So let's look at the dictionary example. I think I already copied that to the server. Let's see. Get all these, click on that, you get your answer. Let's look. And first of all, let's run the server-side code by itself. I can't emphasize this enough, the benefit of doing that. Because that will actually show you what the server is going to be returning. And if that isn't correct, then again, nothing else can work correctly. So that's what we get with JSON. In fact, what I'm going to do, is I'm going to compare our data. XML and JSON. XML. In this case, we end up with a smaller file of JSON. JSON is 868 bytes. XML is like 1,500 bytes. So, almost on the order of almost half as much JSON is. Not quite, but of that order. And I suspect that would be the case in more realistic examples, that you would save quite a bit of space. All right. So let's take a closer look at this, and let me put some extra line feeds in here so that we see exactly what this works like, exactly what this looks like. And I'm going to sort of describe this in words as we break this down. First of all, word list is what? It's an array, right? How do I know it's an array? Because after it, I have the square bracket. So this JSON data consists of an array. What is included in that array? Well, a bunch of elements are included in that array. So as I go in and indent each of those a little bit, everything included in the curly brackets is an array element. And what does each array element consist of? Each array element consists of a word and an index. Now, where are we done with the array? We're done with the array when we hit the last element and then there's a curly bracket. That curly bracket matches up with that curly bracket and indicates that everything between there and there is an array. Each array element, each individual array element, consists of the stuff included in a curly bracket, and every array element included in the curly bracket has a word associated with it, and it has an index associated with it. Now, JSON is called JSON because JavaScript object notation. Alright? Which means the way that we're going to reference these elements is similar to the way that we reference the DOM in JavaScript. And again, that's a similarity with XML, right? Remember, we use commands on XML data just like we use commands on the HTML female dime. Well, we're going to use a similar sort of syntax to refer to JSON data. We're going to refer to the elements in JSON data the same way we refer to elements in JavaScript, refer to objects and their properties in JavaScript. All right, so let's take a look. First, we're going to look at the code that creates the JSON data, and then we're going to look at the code that parses it. I'll spend a minute talking about this stuff because remember when we compared XML to delimited, only two pieces of the puzzle changed, right? Creating the object was the same. Creating the request object was the same, right? Because all that is a pipeline. That's the manner in which we exchange data between the client and the server. So the fact that we're exchanging data, we need one of those objects. It doesn't matter what kind of data we're exchanging. So that's going to be the same whether we use delimited, XML, or JSON. Making the request is the same. We are still asking for the same thing, and we're going to ask for the same thing the same way, by creating a URL and by passing on the URL as part of it, as part of the query string, the specific data that we're interested in. In this particular case, the word or portion of a word that we're interested in. So that part stays the same. What is going to be different, however, is going to be this function. The function that actually parses, that is the function that actually breaks down that big chunk of JSON data into its individual pieces so that we can make a drop down. And that was different for delimited, that was different for XML, and that will be different from JSON. Finally, that last request, remember, we didn't touch that because there was no need to. Sort of simpler even than delimited data is a case where we're getting back just one piece of data from the server. Then there's no parsing involved at all. We simply get back the value from the server and we're done with it. Now again, notice in all these cases, whether we're talking about delimited data, XML, or JSON, we are simply returning back the data. We're not doing any formatting of the data. We're not creating an XML or an HTML table or whatever. The reason for that is, remember, that it's the client's job to format the data. We could actually use the same server-side scripting scripts in a number of different applications that format the data differently. All right? It's the server's job to supply the data because that's what servers do. To manipulate a pre-existing web page and to change the way it looks, that's the job of JavaScript. That was the job of JavaScript since day one in this class. So we leave what we're doing with that data up to the client. In other words, what you could do, I'm not saying it's correct, but what you could do is have your server-side code output a drop-down. And then you just do inner HTML equals, boom, the value of the drop-down. All right? Then you wouldn't have to worry about the code to parse it and break it down. That's not as good as simply sending the data back, because sending the data back, again, each thing services a little component. We could keep that server-side script always pumping out the data, and we could write several different client-side scripts to use that data in a different way. All right? It's sort of like what we did with the function with the tuition calculation. Right? The function for the tuition calculation should simply return a number. This is a tuition. Now, whether that number gets displayed on a page or gets displayed as part of an AJAX application, or we create a table that contains the list of tuitions for the different residency status, that doesn't matter. The function just does its job of displaying the data, and that's what we're going to do here as well. All right. So let's start off looking at the server-side code that actually creates the JSON data. going to be dictionary1.php. We have our include file that contains our two arrays. We grab the value from the query string. We create a result string. But again, compare this to XML. It's very, very, very similar. What's different is the separators between the pieces of data. With XML, we use tags. So let's bring up the XML version of it on the screen next to it. With XML, we started our results equaling a word list tag. Here we start off with that. Pretty much the same idea, though, right? A designation that what we have coming up is a word list. Each iteration through the loop, then, in the case of XML, we outputted the tags for an item, for a word, and for an index. Here we output an array element that contains a word, and the word, the index, and the index. So really, the process to create this is the same. The only thing that's different is what we would probably expect to be different. The stuff that we're putting between the data values, right? Because that's been our whole challenge since the beginning, since we've looked at comparing the three ways of doing this. Excuse me. Is how to separate the data, right? We're sending back data, but we're not sending back one piece of data, we're sending back a bunch of data. Well, how do we tell the client how that data is grouped together? Well, that's our options, right? We can delimit it, we can separate it by semicolons or colons or commas or whatever. We can put it in an XML data, or we can put it in JSON data. So really, the outputting of the data is the same, except the stuff that we're sticking in between the pieces of data. That's really, in a nutshell, the difference between the two. When we're all done, we end our word list. We have a little catch in case there is no words to output a little message in JSON saying that there are no words. And we're done with it. Now, the tough part, again, is actually parsing that data. So let's look at the code that does that for JSON. One thing you might have noticed, I didn't point it out, but I will go and point it out now, is that in the case of HTML, remember that we changed the header that the server was sending out to say, to tell the client that we are sending back that we are sending back XML as opposed to some other kind of data. We do not do that in the case of JSON. So we're not sending back XML. Of course not. We're sending back JSON data. Which means what? Which means that impacts what on the client side? Whether we're sending back XML or not XML. What does that impact on the client side? Close. It affects where the data comes back. And the data either comes back as part of the request object's response text, or it comes back as part of the object's response XML. So that's the two places that the data can come back to the client, either in response text or in response XML. If it comes back as response XML, the client knows it's XML data. So we can instantly start using XML functions. Remember, get tags by ID and that sort of thing. Because we know that what we're getting back is XML. If we send JSON data back, though, we send it back really the same way that we send back delimited data. And that is as part of the response text. So, the client doesn't know that it's JSON data until we tell it to treat it like JSON data. Once we tell it to treat it like JSON data, then we can start using it like JSON data. Well, how do we tell it it's JSON data? We do it this way, with an eval function. We take the response text that we get back from the client, and we use the eval function to create a response object. Response is going to be an object. Well, what properties is that object going to have? Well, it's the properties that we put in the JSON data. So it's going to have a word list property that's going to be an array. And for every element in the word list property, there's going to be a word property, and there's going to be an index property. All right? So effectively what this does is this creates a string. I'm sorry, this takes a string and creates a JavaScript object from it called response. And when we can then use our mechanism and our style of coding to access the properties of that object. All right? So we do all the stuff that we did before. We create an option object. We zero out the length of the dropdown. I then loop how many times? Well, however big the word list is. Executing this statement creates an object. That's the important thing to realize. It takes a string, which is just a string of data like any other string of data, and makes it into a JavaScript object. As a JavaScript object, we can refer to attributes of that JavaScript object. What's one of the attributes of that JavaScript object? The word list. What kind of data is a word list? It is an array. Therefore, I can say response.wordlist in the response object that I created from the JSON string. Look at the word list array and give me the length of it. And that causes this loops statement, these loop statements, to execute one time for every element that is in the word list array that's associated with that JSON data. We then do what? I grab the word attribute for each element in turn. So I will equal 0 the first time through. I will equal 1 the second time through. And so I grab that element in the array and grab the word attribute associated with it. So let's go back to our browser. I ask for the length of the word list array. That counts how many elements are in here. And it looks like there's 27 of them, right? So I'm going to do this loop 27 times. Each time through, I'm going to look at the next element in that array. So the first time through, I look at element 0. The second time through, I look at element 1. The third time through, I look at element 3, and so on down the line. I then ask for that array element. Give me the word attribute. And give me the index attribute. And I use those to create my drop-down element.
Is 21 and 22 missing in that? I see 20 and then it goes to 23.
Good eye. Let's look, see what's up with those. I have a guess as what that is. My guess is capital A. So yeah, this is written to be case sensitive. That's a good, you know, I don't know how many years I've used that, used this example, and I think you're the first student to notice that. But yeah, the matching that I'm doing is case sensitive, therefore it's missing. It's missing those because, yeah. It would also miss these. Yeah, a few others. So, we'll look at what we could do to correct that in a minute. All right, but that's an excellent question. And we need to do that on the server side, right? Because the server side is what's pumping out the data. All right. Okay. So again, we loop through the results that we get. And for each element, we grab the word attribute and the index attribute and create our dropdown. Because again, each element in the array has a word attribute and an index attribute. We pull those out from the return data and we create our dropdown. Questions about this? How are we going to fix this bug though? You're on the right track. I think you have the details incorrect. Let's look and analyze the problem. The offending statement is this one. Because this takes the word that we've entered in and looks to see what position that word is in our English language word. And the problem with that is that if I look for a capital A, it's looking for a capital A. All right? So if I type in a lowercase a, and there's no lowercase a's, but there's a capital A, it's not going to find it.
What if you were to type it in, you know, the user type in a capital A, would those two only show up then?
Good question. Let's try that. Sure does. We essentially have to tell our code that it doesn't matter what case it is. All right? Probably the most straightforward way to do that is I'm going to convert my word and I'm going to convert what the user types in to all lowercase. And then I'll look for the presence of the string. That way, if it's a mix of upper and lowercase, and if it's all lowercase or all uppercase or a mix of both, it doesn't matter because my comparison is only going to look at data that's been converted to all lowercase, both my word and my string. So how do I convert a JavaScript string to lowercase? All right, the to lowercase method does that. So I can go here and say look for the position, not in the word itself, but in the word after it's been converted to lowercase. And I can compare that to the word that I typed in after it's been converted to lowercase. I can save that. What just happened there?
Yeah.
I'm going to rename it to desktop, dictionary, copy, go into JSON. Oh, I know what I did. I copied it. I had two folders both pointing to the desktop instead of one folder pointing to CINET Pub. There we go. Yeah, because that is 909 instead of 940 something. Now we go and do that. Now it's 949. And if I do a refresh, I get a server error. Exactly. Oh. What did I do, being the big dummy that I am? This isn't JavaScript code, this is PHP code. So what I should have looked at is PHP convert, string convert lowercase, and it is str lower. Except it is str2 lower. Wow. One more time. those extra words in there. Now, that's assuming that that's the functionality that we want, which I would think in a case like this, it probably would be. If we type in an A, it would kind of be weird to type in an A and get and not get those things. So, again, I would assume that's the functionality that I wanted. I suppose in some cases that you might want it to be case sensitive. All right. At any rate, are there any questions? I won't post this example. If you want to correct it, you can. It'll be a good exercise for you. The classic instructor disclaimer. Any questions about this? All right. What we will do on Wednesday is we will come here. I have an example, another example that I want to go over real quick, and in the remainder of time, you can work on your any assignments that you have due. I posted an announcement concerning the final and when everything, sort of like the final drop dead due date. All right, we'll see you over in lab. Does anyone have a U.S.